HarperCollins presents The Concert Hall Killer by Jonathan Whitelaw. Read by Sid Sagar. Chapter 1. Locus, Iste. Janice ran as fast as she could, only looking back when she had time to catch a breath. She could feel her lungs burning, her legs turning to jelly. The lactic acid was coursing through her muscles, driving her on and tormenting her at the same time. She knew that if she slowed down, even just a little, he would be on her, and then it would be over. Her feet slapped on the wet pavement. She splashed through the puddles as the rain came down in waves from the bruised and broken sky. The streetlights wobbled as the wind blew hard, a cold Cumbrian night that carried more than a chill for her. She was terrified, scared of slipping, scared of tripping over her own feet. If she did that, she would be down. She couldn't let that happen. She knew too much. She had to escape, had to be rid of him. If she didn't, other people would die. She couldn't let that happen either. Penrith's streets were deserted. She was alone. The shops and businesses on either side of the street were dark and cold. It was the middle of the night. Nobody with any sense was out at this time. They knew better. Janice knew better. Yet here she was, running for her life down an empty high street, hoping and praying she'd see another dawn. Her feet were aching, her legs now cramping. She had to keep going, just a little further. She'd reach the station soon enough, then she'd be safe. She could make the call, and this would be over forever. Only Janice knew that wasn't the case. Everything she'd seen, everything she'd done, it would haunt her for the rest of her life. It was a badge of dishonour, and it was seared onto her chest forever. So why was she running? Why did she still care? Why not slow down? Why not stop? Why not let him catch her? Her body seemed to respond to those thoughts. The pain had grown too much. She was slowing. The long strides became little trots, and eventually she stopped. She bent over double, feeling the rain lashing against her sodden shirt, her breath smoking in front of her in great chugs and plumes, like a steam engine battling uphill. She laughed now, laughed at how ridiculous this had all been. She knew that she could never outrun him. There was no chance of that. Who had she been kidding all of this time? She had wanted to be caught. Before she could consider it all, a big, coarse hand grabbed her from behind. It pulled her upright, quick and sharp. She was forced up against the wall, face pressed against the cold, damp stone. She could feel his breath against the back of her neck. It stank of whiskey, hot and heavy. He leaned in close to her, close enough she could feel his lips almost kissing her ear, and he let out a huge sneeze, so loud that the whole street shook a little. Cat! Simon Nicamber came stomping forward from behind the cameras. The rest of the crew held its collective breath. They'd been here 1,000 times before with a temperamental director. Most of them knew what to expect, and it wasn't pretty.
What the hell was that all about?
Nicamber screamed.
Sorry, Simon, I just had to sneeze, that's all, said Derek, the lead actor.
He wiped his nose on the sleeve of his sodden jacket.
It's all this bloody rain. It's given me a chill, darling. I know I look 21 in some of my headshots, but I'd like to see my 41st birthday, if you don't mind. Why couldn't we film in the Bahamas or something?
The Bahamas? Nicamber asked. Are you serious? You want us to film The Locus about a Cumbrian murderer in the Bahamas? Did I hear you right?
I'm just saying, he said.
It's not like Penrith in the dark and cold is an inviting place, is it? I mean, look at poor Pip down there. She's face-hugging a wall with her feet in a puddle.
Hey, keep me out of this, Derek, said Pip. I'm not the one who ruined the shot. I was waiting patiently for you to murder me.
The leading lady stood up as a runner came and wrapped her in a huge, insulated coat. A cigarette was in her mouth and lit before anyone could blink. The whole set was being stripped and readied for another take, the street awash with people now. Huge spotlights were being repositioned as crew and cameras moved back up the road for first positions. Derek was about to go too when Nakamba stopped him.
"You're on your last chance, your final warning. Are you listening to me, Dale boy?"
he asked, his voice low.
"Hey, back off, Simon," Derek said. "Remember whose name is at the top of this script."
"You've actually read this script, then?"
the director fired back.
"I'm warning you," said the actor. "Lay off me."
He prodded Nakamba in the chest.
"I've heard all about this bad boy attitude you've been trying to get away with," he said. "How you like to throw tantrums, like to smash the setup and go off sulking. Well, that doesn't cut any mustard with me, pal. Got that? I've been nominated for a BAFTA."
"Yeah, a Scottish BAFTA," Pip sniggered.
"The most exclusive kind, I'd say. Anyway, a BAFTA is a BAFTA," Derek scolded her. "And it's more than you've ever had."
"Is that right?"
"Yeah, it is." "Both of you just shut up."
Nakamba's voice really did make the street tremble. All movement on the late night set came to an instant stop. Nobody dared move a muscle or look away.
"Last warning, both of you," said the director. "This production is 3 weeks behind and has gone over budget more times than I can count. I have the network asking me constantly where this block of filming is. I've got the local tourist board hustling me for more cash that we don't have. And I have a headache so bad and so constant that it would make a black hole think twice about swallowing me. I've got a reputation, yes, I admit that. It's a reputation for making quality film and television drama, and it's something I've worked my whole adult life to achieve. So if you think I'm going to let some has-been entertainer waiting out the panto off-season like you, Derek, ruin that, you've got another thing coming."
Pip sniggered again, taking a long draw from her cigarette.
"And as for you..."
Nakamba snapped his head around to his leading lady.
"If you call all of the last 10 minutes acting, then I'd like to meet the moronic sod who said you could make it in this industry.
Have you ever heard of choreography?
No, I don't suppose they teach that for soap operas. Ham acting, maybe. Chewing the scenery, definitely. But not acting. Sort it, or you'll be opening with Prince Charming here at Brighton Palladium, faster than you can say tastefully shot calendar."
The two actors stood like the rest of the crew, their heads bowed. Nakamba gave them both long, hard stares before turning back towards the set. Everyone sprung into action, clearing a 10-meter radius away from the furious director. He liked it that way. It made him feel important and powerful. Why else would he be freezing and wet at 2 in the morning in Penrith? The money, maybe. The art, definitely not. Simon Nakamba was in it for the power. He knew that got him places, got him what he wanted. And right now, he felt as powerful as ever. Chapter 2. The Stars Will Shine Tonight. There was an excited energy about the Penrith Bingo Club tonight. Everyone was talking about the same thing. It was hard luck if you had any other news or gossip. No matter how juicy the rumour, how salacious the whisper or hearsay, there was no room for it. Not tonight. Tonight was all about the Locus. The enigmatic and hugely successful TV show was in town for filming. It was a firm favourite with the Bingo Club, and it would have been hard to find someone who wasn't excited about the cast and crew descending on Penrith. Not that you could have missed them, of course. A fleet of lorries and vans had set up in the middle of the town, blocking off great swathes of streets, alleyways and pavements. Traffic was chaos in the mornings and afternoons, and the local posties were going spare about their deliveries. Not that anyone else really minded. The chance to see Penrith on screen was too good an opportunity to be really mad at. A sense of civic pride had gripped the whole town. and the high watermark of that pride was most definitely the bingo club. Amita Khatri had to wonder, though, where all of this emotion had suddenly come from. In all the years she had been a staple member of the group, she couldn't ever recall seeing them get so jittery or giddy over something like this. And that included a murder and murderer in their midst, and the day they'd run out of biscuits. What was normally a relatively staid and sensible group of pensioners, some in their 90s, was now buzzing around the church hall like a gang of excited schoolchildren. Amita's heart went out to poor Father Ford, who had to herd them all into some sensible shape for the game. He was already 10 minutes late starting, his face like a sweaty rhubarb, fussing by the door and furrowing his brow. Amita was about to get up and go help him when she felt a familiar hand clap her shoulder.
"What have you heard, then?"
asked Georgie Littlejohn.
"Heard about what?"
she asked.
"You know, the filming, the Locus. Everyone is so caught up in it all. I've never seen them like this before. The club, the whole town even, is whipped into a froth."
"Frothing at the mouth, more like," said Amita under her breath. Georgie shot her an unconvinced look. The self-crowned queen of the Penrith Bingo Club had hearing that would rival a Mexican bat, not to mention her hawk-like attention to minutiae and detail. Amita bit her tongue. She shouldn't have been so glib.
"Well?"
asked Georgie expectantly.
"Well, what?" asked Amita back. "What do you know about the filming?"
Georgie had spent the last half hour hoovering up all the gossip and rumour she could from the club members. She had dashed from one side of the hall to the other and back again, assimilating anything and everything she could about the Locus. Amita knew she would only now be bothering her if the rest had been drained of their intel.
"Nothing, really," she said, deliberately disappointing her friend.
"Oh," said Georgie, wrinkling her nose.
"That's not what I heard."
"No?" Amita didn't like the sound of that.
"No, it's not. I heard that you had taken a little wander down to where those big film cameras and lights were spotted on the high street and saw something interesting."
Amita felt her cheeks flushing. It had all been perfectly innocent. She had been out for a walk earlier that day. Nothing wrong with that. In fact, she always liked to go for a walk on a Wednesday to stretch her legs, as she knew she'd be cooped up all evening in the bingo hall. Her natural path from the house had led her into town and, yes, she'd maybe taken a slight detour to see what all the fuss was about. She'd watched the other series of The Locus as keenly as everyone else. She was allowed to be there, wasn't she? But still, she didn't like to include herself in the feeding frenzy of excitement her fellow members had whipped up. After all, in recent years, she'd been busy with real crime-solving rather than the fictional kind on TV.
"I don't know what you mean, Georgie," she said,
fussing with her bingo marker.
"I heard from a very reliable source that you took some pictures," said Georgie. "Some interesting pictures of, say, members of the cast."
Amita felt a tingle run up her arms and down her spine. The excitement of being close to the set, of seeing the huge lighting rigs, the runners, the monitors and, yes, what she thought was a critical scene, came flooding back. It had been exhilarating. She'd never seen any proper celebs before, let alone on her own doorstep. And when she'd snapped a surreptitious picture or two, even she couldn't have anticipated catching a crucial moment.
"I couldn't possibly comment," she said with a wry smile.
"Amita!" Georgie clapped her hands on her thighs.
"You must tell me what you saw. We're all desperate to know something of what they're filming here."
Amita revelled in the attention for a moment. Some of the other regulars from her table were looking and listening now. Judy Moskowitz, the usually level-headed and straight-talking banker's wife, gave her a glare.
"You know something, don't you?" she said.
"She knows! She knows!"
cackled Ethel down the end of the table.
"I wish you lot would leave her alone," groaned Sandy.
"You're worse than the Spanish Inquisition with this silly telly programme."
It is not silly, Sandy, snapped Georgie.
We're enthusiasts, we're fans, and if one of us knows what's going on, then we have a right to know. Isn't that right, Amita?
Amita gave a gentle smile. She nodded over to Sandy, who was huffing.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.